Good day. This is Rene, Encarnacion of CCF San Francisco. Our devotional for today is, in the lockdowns of life, find your greatest hope. Jesus was saying in John chapter 8, verses 31 to 32, he was saying to those Jews who had believed in him, "If you continue in my word, then you are truly disciples of mine, and you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free." It's easy to visualize the lockdown that we're in, whatever name you want to call it, shelter in place, enhanced quarantine, etc. Our movement is limited, outdoor life is severely restricted, activity is curtailed. Physically, we are isolated. There is another kind of lockdown, and it's more spiritual. It existed long before this coronavirus triggered lockdown. And it results from financial pressures, regrets, insecurities, bad habits, addictions, anger and bitterness, fear and anxiety, discouragement and depression. And the greatest problem of mankind almost since creation began, the lockdown due to sin. And from this virus of sin, there is simply no recovery. The mortality rate is 100%. Indeed, our greatest problem is still sin. Our greatest need is forgiveness. And our greatest hope is still Jesus Christ. Now, if we ask our friends, "Do you believe in Jesus?" Perhaps many will say yes. But what does that really mean? Let's think about that. What does it mean exactly when you say you believe in Jesus? Believing in him and knowing him are two completely different things. I grew up being fed a steady diet of religion and catechism in private school. I believed I knew about Jesus. He is the Son of God. He came down from heaven. He was crucified, died, he was buried, and on the third day he rose again. And if I follow his teachings, I will go to heaven after my life here on earth. End of story. Until things started falling apart and life took an abrupt turn, leaving me dazed and confused and totally lost. That's when I realized that Jesus was in my head, but not in my heart, where he belongs. To really know Jesus is to experience him. And in my brokenness, he picked up all the pieces and let me do just that. In the verses above, Jesus was reminding his believers that what it means to be his followers. Continue in my word, he says. It means to abide, to remain, to make it your home. Knowing him is experiencing him, and that is possible only through an intimate relationship with him. A Christ follower does not only know about Christ, he knows Christ personally. Jesus himself prayed in the book of John that eternal life is knowing the one true God and the Son whom he sent. To get to know Jesus personally means you know him as you would a friend. In a friendship, you spend time with the other person and you have vulnerable conversations. Talking regularly is an important part of a relationship. To know Jesus is not just to read about him educationally, but also to spend time understanding who he is. 1 John 5:20 says, "We know that the Son of God has come and has given us understanding, so that we may know him who is true. And we are in him who is true, in his Son Jesus Christ. He is the true God in eternal life." We should pray for understanding so that we can know Jesus and consequently know God. Knowing Jesus begins with believing that he is our Savior who defeated death. If you confess with your mouth, says the book of Romans, that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Knowing God is also believing that he died to save us from our sin. He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, that we might die to sin and live to righteousness, according to the first book of Peter. By his wounds, you have been healed. When you believe in the message of Christ, you are accepted into his family. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. There is even more good news found in John 3:16. For the people who know Jesus and believe in him should not perish, but should have eternal life. Now, knowing Jesus is not based on our works, but it is based on placing our faith in him. Our understanding of Christ is only possible through Jesus' death for our sins. Romans 5:8 teaches, God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. This means that it is not by works that we can know Christ, but through the grace that Jesus bought for us with his life. Ephesians chapter 2 verses 8 to 9 also explains, it is by grace that you have been saved through faith, and this is not of your own doing. It is the gift of God, not as a result of works, so that no one may boast. Now, after learning about Jesus' gift of eternal life given to us, we can then decide to place our faith in him. We can begin to learn more about him personally and spend time with him in prayer, reflecting on his word, worship, fellowship with true believers, and witnessing and sharing the gospel. Let's look into this a little bit more. What is faith exactly? What does it mean to have faith in Jesus? In order to understand what it means to have faith in Jesus, we must understand first the nature of faith itself. It has three elements: knowledge, assent, and trust. First, faith contains the element of knowledge. Faith must have content. There must be something or someone to have faith in. It is popular to say things like, I have faith or I believe, but these sayings are ambiguous and even meaningless until we define in what or whom we have faith. To have faith in Jesus, we must first have some knowledge about who he is. In order to have faith in Jesus, we must first know that he is the Christ, the promised Messiah, who came to earth to save his people from their sins. We must believe that Jesus is God's only Son, who took on human flesh, lived a life of perfect and loving obedience to the Father, willingly sacrificed his life by dying on the cross for our sins, rose triumphantly from the grave after 3 days, and is now seated in heaven at the right hand of God, from where he will return to judge the world and to bring to glory all who eagerly await his coming. Our knowledge of Jesus need not be exhausted, nor can it be, in order for us to believe in him. However, we do need to know some essential truths about who he is and what he has done. Through his sacrifice on the cross, he bridged this bottomless gap between a holy God and sinful man. He provided the only acceptable means by which God, who loves us, extracted divine justice by punishing our sin. He gave us the gift of salvation that we could never earn or deserve ourselves. Second, faith contains this element of assent. To assent means to agree that the knowledge we have is true. Now, we may be tempted to stop here and think we have arrived at a complete definition of faith. However, having knowledge about who Jesus is and even assenting to that knowledge does not mean that a person has faith in Jesus. For example, the devil and the demons know who Jesus is and even acknowledge that, and they tremble, but they do not believe in him. Which brings us to the final element. Faith contains the element of trust. To have faith in Jesus means to trust him. To have faith in him means to rely on him and resign oneself to him. Those who have faith in Jesus rely on him alone as Savior and resign themselves to him as Lord. To trust in Jesus means to believe that his death was accepted by God as payment for our guilt and sin, and that his perfect life and righteousness has been credited to us on the basis of our faith in him. To trust in Jesus is to believe that his teachings and promises are true and to commit ourselves to follow him and to live for him. A helpful analogy which sheds light on the difference between the second element of faith, which is assent, And the third element of trust is as follows. If I were to show you a chair and ask if you believe it would hold you, you may say, yes, it would. You have assented. If I then ask you to sit on it, and you do, you are trusting. You see the difference. Having faith in Jesus means not only agreeing with the fact that he can save, but trusting in him that he both has and will save you. Here's another example, a bit more dramatic, not theological at all. If Jesus told you he can walk a tightrope between one mountaintop and another, thousands of feet above a very perilous ravine with no safety net underneath, you might believe him. If he then asks you to ride on his shoulders while he walks the tightrope, what would you do? You get the point. There are a couple of things to remember about faith in Jesus that are vital to a humble recognition of God's work, grace in us, and to a proper attitude of gratitude to Jesus for who he is and what he has done. First, believing in Christ is a gift from God and is not a reason for us to boast as if we are better or smarter than others. If we indeed have faith in Jesus, it is because God has given us the faith to believe. Secondly, it is Christ himself and not faith that is the grounds for our salvation. Faith is merely the instrument through which we receive Jesus. Faith is like the tube which transports blood in a transfusion. It is the blood, not the tube, that saves the person's life. However, without the tube, the person would not receive the life-saving blood. Comparatively speaking, it is the blood of Jesus that saves us from our morbid and sinful state. And yet, faith is the instrument or means through which we receive Jesus and all the life-giving benefits that he gives. So let's go back. Earlier, I said Jesus is our greatest hope in the lockdowns of life. Believers in Christ know that his promises will all come true in or beyond our lifetime here on earth. The evidence of being a true believer in him is a transformed life that continues in obedience to the word of God. So this is the word of God speaking. God's answer to sin, John 8:36, so if the Son sets you free, you will be free indeed. God's answer to financial pressures, Matthew 6:26, look at the birds of the air. They do not sow nor reap nor store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more than they? God's answer to regret, 2 Corinthians 5:17. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come, the old has gone, and the new is here. God's answer to insecurities, John 1:12. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. God's answer to bad habits and addictions, Romans 6:14, for sin shall no longer be your master, because you are not under the law, but under grace. God's answer to anger and bitterness, Ephesians 4:32, be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you. God's answer to fear and anxiety, John 14:27. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid. God's answer to discouragement and depression, Matthew 28:20. And teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always, even to the very end of the age. If you have not yet put your trust in Jesus and would like to, you can express your faith in him by praying something like the following. The words of this prayer are not what will save you. This is simply a means of expressing your trust in Jesus. Let me lead us in this prayer. Dear God, I know that I am a sinner and that apart from you, I am deserving of eternal death. I believe that Jesus Christ is your Son, that he lived a perfect life, that he died on the cross to pay the penalty for my sin, and that he rose again victorious over sin and death. And I put my faith in Jesus today. I rely on him alone for salvation. Please forgive me for my sins and help me to live for you. Thank you for accepting me and giving me eternal life. Help me to grow closer to you and to live for you. In Jesus Christ's most precious name, we pray. Amen.